Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. We're heading back to the Feld building, and a couple things popped up. This is the bunker window. Oh, right, from inside, we saw that. There's a slit in the concrete here. A sewer? Yeah, we found that. Actually, we're going around this way. So yeah, we're continuing down here. Seems to be the point of no return, but there doesn't seem to be much else to do. I hear voices. So here it is, the point of no return. Where we left off and we talked to Joyce and Everard. Tried to warn other people about what's coming. Or the takeover, or whatever else. Didn't see any options from the people we talked to. Unless that's really not what's happening, because Everard just wanted us to tell Joyce. And we tried to ask Lillian on the date for a couple tries, but we really had just 3%, so nothing really came of that. Here there lies Dingjaw. What's this? It feels strange. A concrete pipe buried in sand and dust. R$40. I don't know if we could spend it anywhere. Another R$115. Well, that wasn't R$40, but .40. Alright, that's the end there. So it feels strange. Oh. Ruby the Instigator. Oh my god. Suddenly, your entire body is paralyzed. Aggressive white noise fills your skull. A strange pain like you've never felt before. Through the static, you hear a woman's voice. Perception, hearing, says it's like 1,000 radio stations are being blasted into your head all at once, but her words are the only ones you can make out. Damn.
I know you're feeling pretty uncomfortable right now. Don't move too much or fight it. That'll just make it worse.
Says the shadowy figure by the machine. Could she be behind the noise that almost destroyed that church?
Can't say it's a pleasure, officer. I was really hoping not to make your acquaintance. But here we are.
It's like she's talking through something. Pain Threshold says, as she says the word officer, you feel a spike in the agony. It sounds like entire radio frequency range is screaming directly into your neural pathways. Cover your ears. Oh boy. No, buddy, that's not going to help. You can't shield yourself from this. It's an entirely new type of experience. Way worse than all the previous ones. Okay. I'm gonna heal my health a little bit. Unfortunately, I don't have much left for that. Volition says, don't focus on the pain. Focus on doing your job. Tell her she's under arrest. Yelling through the static, you're under arrest.
Really now? Check this out.
She turns a dial in her hand. Oh boy. You're overwhelmed with a new surge of violent static. It feels like a blood vessel exploded in your brain. What's happening to me?
I'm using a pale latitude compressor. You and your partner have been caught in its field.
A pale latitude compressor. Logic says the explosion of static you're hearing, it's the ULAN frequency. Oh yeah, we just learned a little about that from her lorry. Blasted from that pale emitter, Fat Angus mentioned. I saw your equations, it's the ULAN frequency.
Saw my equations? You've been sniffing through my lorry, right? I expected as much. Well, I am a bit surprised you knew what you were looking at.
Okay. The pale latitude compressor is going shh. and then saying some numbers. I don't know if these are important at all. I have any bearing on anything.
A pale latitude compressor is used to sort of make the pale more manageable. With a lot of these, you can force a radio signal grid on the pale. Literally crunch the distance across it. Signals are relayed across a series of repeater stations fixed to buoys. Not a fun job manning those stations. All alone out there in the pale. People lose their minds in just a few years.
So, what we are experiencing is a concentration of radio waves.
He gestures towards something with great effort.
Precisely. This is an industrial strength paraboloid. It's meant for forcing dimensions on something that doesn't have them. Needless to say, the frequencies used are out of this world.
How do we stop her?
At the upper limit is the large prime number generator station. It's used specifically for pale latitude compression. That's why you might be hearing some numbers. But you might also hear, or think you're hearing, local radio chatter.
Right, we heard that from back at the beginning of this cavern. A large prime number generator station. Rhetoric says she likes telling you about the machine. Keep her talking. Look for an opportunity to break loose. How'd you get your hands on this thing?
I built it myself.
She nods toward her torture device. Interfacing says, and she's proud of it too, as she ought to. This is way beyond your abilities.
That's illegal. I'm guessing it's patented. But we are beyond that, aren't we?
Oh yeah, way beyond.
She studies her death ray and the law officials trapped in it. Have you experienced the compressor yourself?
Yeah, I stuck my head in there before using it on you. Seemed like the ethical thing to do. Can't say that I enjoyed it. The field was weaker, but I can imagine what you're going through.
Will I stay like this forever?
No. Once I shut down the compressor, the pain will end. It may take a few minutes for you to steady yourself, though. It's a bit like walking out of a very confusing dream.
Or waking out of it. Okay, more hisses, numbers, and words we do not understand. This is all great, but let's talk about the man who was killed.
Yeah, let's not talk about that shit. You were hunting me and fell into my trap instead. That's all there is to say about it.
Rhetoric says, so she thinks of you as hunters, not cops, and of herself merely as prey. Please, could you just turn it down so I can ask you something?
If you've got something really important to say, you can do it through the white noise.
Okay, this thing is saying if you're looking for a deal on mattresses, so speed for Rosaline.
Damn this!
The lieutenant clutches his head, grimacing.
God damn it!
She regards you and Kim with sudden sympathy.
Fine. If you really want to talk, I can dial it down. I've also got a gun, by the way.
She steps reluctantly out of the shadows. The pain lessens. The perception she's carrying, perception sight says, is a two-barreled front loader, not like the murder weapon. Pain threshold says, well, it doesn't feel much better, but you can form sentences now. Thinking doesn't seem to hurt as much. Destroy the machine. Oh, I have the tool equipped. That's a good thing. How did you know we were coming? I heard you in the passages, and I've been preparing for quite a while. By hiding bullets under floorboards? So you found my shack, huh? I'm not surprised. Empathy says her tone is bitter. She thinks she's been betrayed. She didn't rat you out, by the way, Isobel, the washerwoman. So nice. She smiles a little smile. That's one knife I didn't want to find in my back. Rhetoric says, as opposed to the other knife she's finding there now. Hardy, for one. So I've got a gun. Preparing for the worst, I guess? You don't need that. Not anymore, no. This could have turned out pretty bad for me if you hadn't walked right into 25 bands of ultra-high frequencies. Rhetoric says, that's her admitting the bullet was an emergency exit. Did you shoot Lely? No, I didn't do it. I only helped stage the lynching, though I doubt that makes much of a difference to you. Who ratted me out, by the way? Was it Titus? No, she hesitates. He wouldn't have broken first. You're right. Clashe was the first to share her suspicions. Oh, she smiles sadly. I knew the kitten had claws, but not like this. But she couldn't have known I was on the coast. How'd you find me? Your first guess. Oh, Titus? Your own boys told us you were on the coast. Let's not single out Titus. My boys? Okay. Okay, Ruby boys, formerly the Hardy boys. She looks at you incredulously. What? I don't even understand what you're trying to get at here. Oh, it doesn't even matter. How can he be my boys? We're not even my friends. And those guys liked me. I know it. If this is what happens to people whom people like... Volition says, a dull despair is creeping into her voice. How the hell do the rest of us get by? Wait, wasn't it you who called me the human can opener? It's not personal. I opened them up. I did, didn't I? And now you've come for me, she scoffs. But screw them all the same. Empathy says that did make her forgive them. A little. I do it by asking questions, and I have some for you. Like what? She adjusts her grip on her gun. I already told you I didn't do it. Rhetoric says, a strong moral compass. She still wants the opportunity to make a case for herself. Do you have an alibi for when Lely was shot? Man, I was with the boys the whole night. I hope they at least bothered to impress that upon you. They did say you left to take... okay, there were 10 minutes they couldn't account for. Didn't seem like 15, but could have been. You mean the length of a toilet break? That wouldn't have even been enough time. I said 10 minutes, now we got 15 minutes. Hold on, no one takes a 15-minute leak. Look, screw you, man. I might have also stopped by the bar. Drama says, she speaketh truth. Our investigation has shown that 15 minutes was just enough time to commit the murder. Wow, now I'm curious. Please explain. Play pinball much? No, not since I was 14 and hanging out the only diner in Dardan. Haven't been into low-risk, no-reward games since moving to the city. Why? There are some mysterious pinball machines and some pretty mysterious rooms in the Whirling. Yeah, and probably some ghosts from the time of the Suzerain. I'm not really interested in supernatural mysteries. Wait, what kinds of mysteries interest you then? Not murdering mysteries either, if that's what you're thinking. She looks you in the eye impassively, making it clear that she's not planning to comment on the matter any further. What about elevators? Do you like elevators? No, the elevators have to do with anything. Do you or don't you? Not particularly. Why not? Why are you so hung up on elevators? Logic says, that's a pretty good question, actually. She clearly doesn't know anything about the secret passage. Interesting. Not even quaint old rickety ones? I'm not really into old crap for old crap's sake. God damn it. The lieutenant grabs his head. Conceptualization says, so you know she's not an antiques enthusiast. Not my jurisdiction, man, but it also doesn't sound like she used that secret route at all. Look, there's a secret way from the ground floor of the Whirling to the roof. Don't know it, but also, she frowns, studying your face. The shot couldn't have come from the roof, or we would have all heard it downstairs. Silence her? She has a point there. No one mentioned. The pain stops him from finishing the sentence. Suggestion says, that didn't go super well. You've got to lay something better on her. I'm going to lay this all. Would you say that Lily was a likable person? I didn't like him. Hardened mercenaries aren't particularly likable types. You don't feel sympathy for mercs? It's hard work. Plenty of broken people who don't come with that kind of body count. Besides, they're paid well for what they do. Do you feel protective of the Union? Yeah, sure, and I didn't like Wild Pine sending in all those foreign hirelings. Me and a hell of other people around here. Empathy says she didn't hate him, okay? I have other questions. I'm listening. You have a gun. And? Where'd you get it? The gun store. What gun store? Trigger Happy Jacks. Really? Trigger? What did you think? That I'm gonna squeal on my gun supplier? Sorry, I'm not that kind of gal. I see it's a front loader. Do you have another gun somewhere? Sure don't. A breech loader? Kim says. No. Hand-eye coordination says, this is such a wipeout. I can't quite tell. What kind of gun is it? A Noctway 80 front loader. Two-barreled. Not really what you were looking for, I'm guessing. That isn't it, Kim says. I know you don't like old things, but do you sell antique rifles on the side? Never really got into weapons trafficking, especially not old weapons. They break too often, and you don't want unhappy customers among gun collectors. If she was the killer, she's not going to just tell us, right? That would be all these questions would be her just telling us. Wincing, there's other evidence I want to ask you about. Yeah? Evidence. Do you like to hang out on rooftops? Who doesn't? Oh, you probably mean Clashier's rooftop. Sure, I've hung out there. She's got this great antenna. What's so great about her antenna? It's very powerful. I use it to tune into RCM frequencies. That's how I knew to be prepared for your arrival. The latitude compressor saying, come in. Is that the only reason you hung out on the roof? The view's pretty bomb, too, but you might say the antenna was the main attraction there, yeah. Along with Clashier. So you're sure you didn't shoot the merc from the roof? Yes, I'm sure. And anyway, as I said before, the shot had to have come from afar. You're running drugs for the Union. I've been through your lorry. She shakes her head slowly. So Heart of Gold Tommy screwed me over, too. Never trust a musician. Empathy says, that really comes as a blow to her. No, he didn't. I found my own way in. Okay, great. You got into my lorry on your own. What now? You going to arrest me for drug trafficking? A bitter smile. Yeah, I feel bad for Tommy, so figured let's unimplicate him. Empathy says, beneath it, she's relieved Tommy didn't betray her. Okay. You're a criminal. I can't trust anything you say. So why are you asking her all these questions? She scoffs. That's your prerogative. You had a financial incentive to kill the merc. Man, it's to get away from all that murderous crap that I left Jamrock, my previous employer, for the Union. The lieutenant is unable to articulate his question. Rhetoric says, she deliberately avoided naming the mob she worked for. You might be able to find this out later. She turns the knob down, just a millimeter, then continues, I got lucky being a dispatcher. Never had to do any of the really dirty work myself. This gun, she glances at it, has only been used for self-defense against serious scum. Pain threshold says there. It's going to be easier to reach the machine now. But you're threatening us with it. Based on what I've heard about you, you are serious scum, she responds, holding her gaze. Okay, let's take a step back. Yeah? Where? A suggestion says more. More questions before doing anything. Okay. Plus one. We get an additional plus one for nudged it during drugs talk. Still have a very good chance, but I want to see what she has to say to all this stuff anyway. The suggestion is recommending it anyway. Who killed the Merc, if it wasn't you? What was it, Sunday night? Tell me your version. And killing my hide. Yeah, go. Good questions. Who killed the Merc, if it wasn't you? How should I know? As I keep saying, he already had a bullet in his head when I got to him, and there hasn't been any useful gossip over the radio. Perception sight says those rings around her eyes, her tired voice, she's been staying up late listening in on the conversations crisscrossing Martinez. Police radio, Kim says. You've been following the case? Who hasn't? She shrugs. You know, I can still see him there, in Classier's room, lying on his side. He was still warm, but the bluish light coming through the broken window made him look as though he'd been dead for a good long while. If you didn't kill him, why hide? I saw you roll into town. I wasn't about to stick around for questioning by a goddamn La Puta Madre again. La Puta Madre agent. What do you mean, La Puta Madre agent? She looks at you quizzically. Yes, you. Everyone says you're his peon. The human can opener. Oh boy, I hurt my health again. Through the sudden sharp pain in your head, you hear the lieutenant mumble something to himself. Perception hearing says, bleeping hell and why me, you hear through the white noise. Shall I use another one? Pain threshold says, it's especially bad suddenly. Felt like a vein exploded. Okay, I only have one more. Everyone says you're his peon. Who's everyone? How do you know this? Everyone in Jamrock. The cops, the criminals. Why do you think I'm holed in here with a goddamn death ray waiting for you? Logic says if she knows that about you, she must know your real name, too. Tell me, what's my name? If you know that about me, you must know my name. Harry Dubois, she replies quickly. One corrupt MF with the disco pants and the funny tie. Agent to La Puta Madre. Volition says, so she knows your name. That doesn't mean you're on the take. Criminals make up boogeyman stories about cops all the time. Logic says, all this just means that you're effective. Criminals know you and are scared of you. Hell yeah, I'm a La Puta Madre agent. You better let me go. Nah, that I'm not planning to shoot you is the extent of the courtesy I can extend to La Puta Madre at the present. What did you do to this Madre anyway? You've been my lorry. You've been to my lorry. You think the biggest player in Jamrock appreciates competition? She pauses. And now I have Harry can opener in my hair. Titus. Suggestion says she's not going to change her mind that easily. She still perceives you as a threat. Rhetoric says, wait, one thing, possibly small, but she said you town. Was that you singular or plural? She might know something. When I came into town, was there anyone with me? Yeah, you had your death squad with you. What happened to them anyway? Who was in this squad? Well, it wasn't this scrawny dude. She nods toward the lieutenant. You had two guys and a lady. The guys looked pretty buff. Lady wasn't bad either. Two guys and a lady. Well, my partner is down in the whirling in rags, and there's a lady there. If it's them two, but then who's the other guy? What else can you tell me? One of the guys seemed chipper, a blonde. The other had a brooding something or other about him. And the woman was the only one in uniform. All were carrying. She narrows her eyes. That sound about right? Logic says no idea who these people are, literally. Yeah, agreed. Esprit de Corps says, Satellite Officer Vic Mayer looks out of the window grimly, then puts his coffee down and turns to Patrol Officer Minot. We can either take a room here in the Whirling or go home for today. Is this a memory I'm getting here? Satellite Officer Vic Mayer, Patrol Officer Minot. Vic Mayer and Minot. Let's go home, Jean. Nothing's going to happen today, she responds quietly. Jean takes his blonde wig off. Cole Heidelstam. He can give us a ride. Okay, that's the partner then, I think. I think I know them. They're in Martinez. The compressor says, friction lock set. Don't leave me here, please, Solis. Fantastic. I've got to get on the road. Then you can go find your friends, unless you have anything pressing to ask me. What happened Sunday night? Tell me your version. She eyes you warily, as though gauging your sincerity. It's okay. We just want to... He struggles to finish the sentence. All right, don't kill yourself over it. I was shooting the crap with Hardy and the boys over a few beers, like always. Then Clashy comes in, all pale and shuddering. She sits down with a drink, trying to steady her nerves, so I grab a seat next to her. Wait, did she also seem high to you? Yeah, super. But I didn't think too much of it at first. I'd seen her party hard before. Clashier said you knew something was wrong immediately. No, I really didn't. She's not that easy to read. I just assumed she'd done too much blow. It wouldn't be a first for her, but no such luck. She was in some deep crap. She asked me to come upstairs. The merc she'd been going with was lying dead on the bath. Was lying on the bathroom floor dead. I knew she couldn't get the authorities involved, so yeah. Kim says, you made it look like he'd been hanged. It's pretty weird that you came up with this plan right on the spot. What? No. Faking a lynching was her idea. It was her idea. Yeah, in cold blood. It really surprised me how quickly she was able to get a hold of herself once we got up there. It was like she was another person. The party girl was gone. She asked me to help drag him into the shower so she could wind the shower head around his neck to fake lividity. Then she dressed him while I went to get the Hardy boys. Volition says, Clashier knew exactly what she was doing. You can't remain calm under pressure otherwise. Okay. So did she specifically set this up, right? She herself didn't kill him, but she had someone else kill him, so thus had sex with him, left the window, blinds open or curtains open, whatever. And boom, shot, and then she knew what to do. She knew exactly what to do. She had it planned out. Drama says she lied to you about that, too. She wind a shower head around his neck. That's bad that she'd be so calm. Yeah, I wasn't sure whether to admire her or be disturbed. Do you think she killed Lely herself? As I keep telling you, cops, we didn't hear anything downstairs. No gunshot, nothing. We need to find her partner. But even if this is true, the lieutenant forces himself to finish the sentence. Weren't you worried this lynching might lead to... war? She purses her lips. The thought crossed my mind, but the mercenary's death was going to have repercussions either way. Although, the way things are going... Drama says she doesn't want to talk about this, but not because she has something to hide. She doesn't want the guilt. She shrugs. Screw it. I'm not responsible for these people after what they did to me. Do you know about the bunker next door? What bunker? Just a bunker. Have you been there? Don't know anything about it. No one's been around since I set up camp, but I'm sure I'm not the first vagabond to... Her voice trails off into white noise in your head. It feels like an aneurysm approaching. Oh boy. Lambord, starburst, and sunshine, 24 degrees centigrade. Savoir Faire says, keep calm, breathe in. After the pain recedes, it's a little clearer. Okay, we got another plus one for momentary window of clarity. Pretty sure we didn't go up. We were 97%, I think, the whole time. Destroy the machine. Success, I hope? We would have to get two ones to fail, I think, only. Awesome. You did it, Pain Threshold says. The compressor lies broken on its side. It's quiet in your head again. It still hurts like hell, but... You're under arrest. She looks at the machine, assessing the damage. Her hand trembles. Ah, screw it. She puts the barrel of the gun into her mouth. Rhetoric. If I choose this... I'm just going to go for this. Because I'm afraid if I choose this, she'll do it, right? Still high choice. High chance. Minus one for admitted Madre agent. Try to convince her to put the gun down. She's truly desperate, Rhetoric says. She thinks she has no other options. You need to give her options. What options? You know. Maybe I can still talk her out of it? This is how you talk her out of it. It's the only scenario in which she lives. Please, putting her hands up, just walk away. She stares at you, frozen, the gun still in her mouth, eyes filled with dark intensity. Then something shifts in her. Empathy, says gratitude, doubt. She's still ready to go. Composure says her neck and shoulders relax, and her grip on the gun loosens. You don't have to do this. You're not cornered. I'm letting you go. Day of miracles, she says, pulling the gun out of her mouth, eyes still fixed on you. Then she turns her gaze to the tunnel behind you. I'll take it. I feel like this is a mistake. She runs past you, then past the lieutenant, and disappears into the darkness of the tunnel. Good call. The lieutenant is still unsteady on his feet. Are you sure? Yeah, I'm sure. He has to catch his breath. I would have done the same had I not been incapacitated. What if we just let the murderer go? I have a feeling we didn't. He looks around, then points to the back of the cavern. Her tent. We should check it out. Ruby's gone. Go to her tent. All right. Wow. Cooking utensils. She has prepared herself porridge with bananas. Druamine, plus 3 health. Oh, sweet. Is that a... I guess that's a this thing. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. I had one left. 8 real. Nice. She forgot her money. Dark water trails into the distance. There is no way out. And I see we cannot advance further this way. Instigator's tent. The plain red tent stands by dispassionately. This way, it looks like a brownish yellow. Savoir Faire says, it was pitched by practiced hands. She's used to camping out. The tent looks old, but well maintained. In the darkness of the tent, a rolled-up sleeping bag, cooking utensils, some books, and a kerosene lamp. Perception smell says it reeks of cigarettes. Look at the books. Assorted soft covers, mostly pulp horror. A motor carriage lies buried in the snow on one cover. On another, a ghost airship. You also see a collection of radio enthusiast magazines. The lieutenant peeks in over your shoulder. See anything? Rega Monthly, Journal of Material Science, more technological digests. One of the magazines doesn't have images on the cover. It's not a magazine, it's a leather notebook. a notebook. You pocket the worn brown leather journal. Inland Empire says, a trusted friend left behind. We should read this immediately, Kim says. Like, right now. Okay.